الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا الله صلى على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى السلام عليك يا سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا غريب كربلاء رزقنا الله في الدنيا زيارتكم وشفاعتكم في الدنيا والآخرة أما بعد فمما جاء من كلام سيدنا ومولانا الإمام الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه أنه قال لا تغتروا بصلاتهم ولا بصيامهم فإن الرجل ربما لهج بالصلاة والصوم حتى لو تركه استوحش ولكن اختبروهم عند صدق الحديث وأداء الأمانة صدق مولانا الإمام الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم وعجل Today, the 25th of this month of Shawwal coincides with the Shahada of our sixth Imam, Ja'far ibn Muhammad As-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajil farajhum. He was born in the year 83 after Hijrah. Lived 12 years with his grandfather, Al-Imam As-Sajjad alayhi salam, and then an additional 19 years with Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. So how old was the Imam when Imam Al-Baqir died? 12 and 19. MashaAllah, brothers, what's happening here, MashaAllah? I thought we have some business people here, you know. But it's getting late, I think, in the day. He was about 31 years old, give or take, when he took the responsibilities of Imama, or assumed the responsibilities of Imama, and that lasted for 34 years, making him one of the oldest living Imams, martyred in the year 148 Hijri, at the age of about 65 years old. 3 weeks later, in the same year, about 3 weeks later, Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salam was born. So in about a few weeks, we will be celebrating on the 11th of Dhul Qa'dah, inshallah, the wilada of Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salam. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. His grandson, he was born in the same year. So 3 weeks later, the wilada of the Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salam. One important aspect that Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam invested much of his life on was to educate people about the essence of Islam, which consists of three things. I mentioned in the past, Islam is a triple A religion. A for aqa'id, aqidah, which means theology, belief. A for ahkam, laws or jurisprudence. And A for akhlaq, manners or morality. These three things. If one has solid understanding of the aqidah, of theology, coming from genuine and pure sources like Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, then this individual, Hassan Jazakallah Khair, then that would reflect on this person's implementation of the ahkam. The greater the belief, the greater the understanding of the aqa'id, of usul al-deen, then the greater the implementation of the ahkam. Once ahkam are implemented to the fullest degree, with understanding, based on pure understandings of the aqidah, then that will be reflected on a person's actions or interactions, what we call akhlaq. What is akhlaq? It is what you see of people. Although what you see of them is based on their inner sense, inner self, which stems on their actions. You see now how faith relates to laws and how laws relate to morality or action. This is the connection. What's important is to make sure that those three dots are connected correctly. Any problem in here, there's a problem in the understanding of religion. Let me give you one quick example to realize how important is what I'm talking about. When Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam chose someone to represent him as an ambassador to Kufa, who did he choose? Muslim ibn Aqil, correct? Okay. This person whom he chooses has to be a true reflection of the religion. He's the ambassador of the Imam salamullahi alayhi. Someone who understands the aqidah, strong, solid foundation in the aqidah, coming from pure sources, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, which then will be reflected on his ahkam, on his laws, and that will be reflected on his interactions, correct? Okay. Muslim ibn Aqil arrives in Kufa originally. Then about 18 to 25,000 people pledge their allegiance to him. He stays sometime in the house of Hani ibn Urwa. When Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad arrives in Kufa, he comes with a man called Shariq al-A'war. Both of them come to Kufa together. Shariq goes and stays in the house of Hani ibn Urwa. Shariq becomes ill. Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad wants to pay his respect, so he wants to come and visit Shariq in the house of who? Hani ibn Urwa. Shariq then tells Muslim, he says, Muslim, Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad is coming today to see me. You hide behind the curtain with your sword. When I find the right moment, I'm going to give you a sign, a signal. When you hear my signal, come out and finish him off. Khalas. What is the signal? I will say, I am thirsty, get me water. That will be your cue. Good. Muslim stands behind the curtain. Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad comes, alone, with no guards, enters into the house of Hani ibn Urwa, sits alone, unarmed, and he is talking to Shariq. How are you? You're okay? You know, how are you feeling? Etc., etc. Shariq finds the moment is perfect. I am thirsty, get me water. Nothing happens. I'm thirsty, get me water. Nothing happens. He repeats it again. Nothing happens. He started reciting a poetry, a verse of poetry. You know, Where are you? I'm thirsty. Get me the water. It's a verse of poetry that he started reciting. Nothing happens. Later on, Ubaidullah gets up and he turns to Hani ibn Urwa. He says, poor Sharik, I think there's something wrong with his head. You know, I think this illness has kind of, you know, I don't know why he's always asking for water, for water. So he didn't get it. He didn't get what the signal was. And he leaves. Imagine if Muslim had killed Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad at that moment. History may have changed. Because Kufa at that moment was in the hand of Muslim, not in the hand of Ubaidullah at that moment. Muslim had about 25,000 people who pledged their allegiance to him. If he had killed Ubaidullah, Imam al-Hussein may have arrived in Kufa. The people of Kufa may have supported him. They may have even won the war against Yazid ibn Mu'ayyad. The whole history could have changed. Then you tell Muslim, why didn't you come out? So Sharik got upset at Muslim. He told him, Muslim, why didn't you come out? I gave you the cue several times. He said, because of two reasons. One, I didn't want to kill him in the house of Hani ibn Urwa. That's one. But that's really the minor problem. The main point, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Al-Iman qayyad al-fatk. What does that mean? It means Iman, pure faith, pure religion, Iman. Pure, it prevents a person from stabbing someone from behind. Betrayal. A true mu'min does not betray. I know the opportunity was there, but the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi prevented me from coming out and killing him in this manner. We kill, but on the battlefield. That's how we, you know, facing the enemy, not from behind. That's not our tactics. Plus, first of all, it is dishonor to kill someone from behind. That's the dishonor. We from Bani Hashim, we don't dishonor. We don't do these kind of actions. Second, the hadith of the Prophet. When the Prophet says a mu'min doesn't do it, khalas. How many of us would have done that? And we're talking about Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, huh? We're not talking about some mu'min, some muttaqi, you know. Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, who later on takes the head of Muslim himself, you know. Correct? You see the importance of aqidah? That's the aqidah that we need to have. That's the aqidah of the Shia. That's what a Shi'i is. He has such kind of understanding of religion. And he implements the ahkam. The Prophet says a hadith, khalas, that's it. I will live by that hadith, even if it means my head is going to be taken off later on. Khalas. How many of us do that when we deal with each other? Okay. That's what Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam had to ensure. By that time, people started to develop different theologies, different ideologies, different beliefs. People started to read the Quran and interpret it any way they seem to see fit. We have tadabbur al-Quran. Tadabbur of Quran means you, if you understand Arabic, if you know Arabic, or if you read the translation, you read what the ayah says and you try to implement it to the best of your ability. You think about the ayah. That's called tadabbur al-Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Quran says, don't they reflect? Let them think about what they're reading. So if you read, whether if you understand Arabic or you read the translation, when the ayah says, for example, أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ establish salat, you raise your hand and say, Ya Allah, make me among those who establish salat, for example. When the ayah says, for example, fear Allah, you say, Ya Allah, make me one among those who fear you, Ya Allah, for example. When the ayah says, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا do not do ghiba of each other, do not backbite one another. You say, Ya Allah, don't make me among those who backbite, وَالْعِيَاضُ بِاللَّهِ That's tadabbur of Quran. This is tadabbur, this is simple. You basically read the ayah and whatever you understand, you ask Allah to give it to you. That's easy. Then there is interpretation of Quran, tafsir of Quran. Tafsir of Quran is what Allah intended in the ayah, what Allah wanted. Can anyone know who what Allah wanted? Of course not. That's why not anybody can pick up the Quran and say, well, Allah means this, we should do that. Yes. How do you know this? Well, because Quran is for everyone. Of course, Quran is for everyone to do tadabbur, not to do tafsir. tafsir, you have to understand the Quran. You have to know Arabic language, study Arabic very well. You have to know Arabic grammar, Arabic literature. Then is that enough? Of course not. Then you have to read the ahadith of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Read the laws, the ahkam. And use all these resources that the mufassirin use until you can come up with an interpretation of the Quran. And many of the mufassirin, they try their best, the best of their abilities. It's not that this is the be-all and the end-all. That's their best understanding of the ahadith of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Now, if you don't have Ahlul Bayt, then there is a huge problem. Then you're doing it on your own opinion. That's why Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam turns to one of the famous Sunni scholars in his time by the name of Qatada. Qatada. He says, Qatada, I heard that you interpret the Quran, you do tafsir. He said, yes. He said, based on what? What is your basis for doing tafsir of Quran? What do you have to do tafsir? He had no answer. Imam asked him a couple of questions, didn't answer. He said, you better stop doing tafsir of Quran because that's not your business. But did he stop? No, he didn't. Same discussion took place between Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam and Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man. Abu Hanifa. Today, in the Sunni school of thought, there are four schools. Any Sunni that you see today, he will tell you, if he knows. Some of them don't even know. If he knows, he says, I'm one of those four. Either follows Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, he says, I'm a Hanafi, who is a direct student of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. Imam Hanifa spent 2 years with Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, and he has this famous quote of hadith, his famous hadith, his saying, where he says, if it weren't for the 2 years, I would have perished. And I don't know any, all the knowledge I have comes from these 2 years. لولا السنتان لهلك النعمان. His name was Nu'man. You know. Abu Hanifa, he says, I am Hanafi, or Imam Malik, the Malikis, who is also a student of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. Or he says, I am Hanbali, or Shafi'i, who are students of Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi'i, both of them. So eventually they all go back to Abu Hanifa, he goes back to Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, all of them. All the knowledge they have. Abu Hanifa, one of the four schools of thoughts. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, one day asked him, on what basis do you give fatwa? You give fatwa to people. You tell them this is halal. This is on what? Based on what? What is your back? What is your resources? What's your proof? He says, I try to use my deductions. He said, your deductions? He says, since when is religion run based on deductions? What you think? It's based on what Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say. And that only comes from us, Ahlul Bayt. That's our teachings. Imam asked him a few questions, he couldn't answer. Then he told the Imam, he said, you know what, I will stop, khalas. You know, I understand, I am unworthy of giving fatwa anymore. Imam looked at him and he said, no, you will not stop, because the love of power is very tasteful to you. You love power. To be, you know, treated with respect, with dignity, people come to you, yes, scholar, sheikh, you know, so on and so forth. This has a lot of taste. Now, so you had people of this caliber, these individuals, who were students of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, but they were of this kind. So Imam alayhi salam had to ensure that there are a group of people who know, they understand the essence of the Quran. They are taught the right teachings, the right aqidah. In addition to this, Muslims started at that point interpreting Greek philosophy. Plato, Aristotle, their ideologies now started to infiltrate Muslims. So people started to be influenced by these ideologies. Imam had to also clarify what Islam says. You cannot take an ayah and tailor it to fit what Aristotle says, or what Plato says. Or you take what Plato says and take an ayah and kind of try to fit it, that this is what it means. You cannot do that. You have to go according to what the ayah means. That's tafsir of Quran. In addition, then there is the hidden meaning of the Quran. The ayah has a hidden meaning, and that's called ta'wil. And no one knows ta'wil illa Allah wa rasikhuna fil ilm. Allah and those who are well versed in knowledge, whom Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam says, we are the ones. That's ta'wil, the deeper meaning of the Quran. So when it comes to theology, Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam invested a lot of time on his companions. One of his companions, one day, Husham ibn al-Hakam, great Shia. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam told him, Husham, you're going to go back to Kufa. When you go back, there is an atheist there, somebody who does not believe in religion. What he's going to tell you, he's going to bring you some rotten meat. In that meat, there will be a lot of worms. And he's going to argue with you. He's going to tell you, if you claim that your God can create, I can also create. Look at this fresh piece of meat. It has no worms. Leave it for a few days, and guess what? Now it has all these worms, which means I am the one who created all these worms. That's what he's going to tell you. How are you going to respond to him? He said, what shall I say, Ibn Rasulullah? What am I going to say? He says, well, this is what you tell him. Any creator understands and knows thoroughly what he created. Ask him, is that true or not? He will tell you, yes, it is, obviously. If you're the maker, if you're the creator, then you know what you created. He tells, then tell him, then follow it up with the following question. Tell him, how many worms? Count them. Tell me, without counting them, tell me how many worms are there? If you created them. He won't be able to answer you. Second, tell me which one are the males, which one are the females? No. Tell me. And again, he won't be able to answer. Then you tell him, Allah is the creator, not you. Okay. And exactly as the Imam said happened, that atheist's jaws dropped and he looked at Husham. He says, I am certain this did not come from you, because this was in Kufa. He said, I'm sure this came from Hijaz, from Medina. These questions that you presented to me came from Medina. What does he refer to in Medina? What does he mean? He knows. Came from him. These didn't come from you. And there are several of such examples. Another man comes to Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, and he says, people are questioning me about the existence of God. Is there a God? Is there no God? SubhanAllah, the same questions that today people are posing. Same questions today. People were posing them then. Imam tells him, he says, okay, go back to him. Tell him, what do you do for a living? He'll tell you that he travels. Tell him, have you ever experienced a situation where while you're traveling on a ship, a big storm came and started rattling the ship back and forth to the point where you thought you're going to die? He will tell you, yes, it happened. Then you follow it up. Tell him, when you felt that you're going to die for sure, khalas, the ship is going back and forth, it's rocking, and the water is coming, and you felt it's over. At that moment, did you feel your heart connected to some power that can save you? He'll tell you, yes. Then you tell him, that is God. That is Allah. That is what Allah refers to as fitrat Allah, the instinct that Allah has created in every human being. When the human being feels finished, it's over, khalas, no matter who he is, even if he is Fir'aun, what did Fir'aun say when he was dying, when he saw death is imminent, khalas, the water is coming, what did he say? Now I believe in the God of Musa and Harun. Even if it's Fir'aun, who used to say, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, I am your grand God, wal'iyadu billah. That's what he used to say. But at that moment when he felt, khalas, it's over, oh no, I believe. The answer came. Some of us say the angels responded, because he was dying now, khalas, it's finished. He was now seeing the barzakh. He's seeing he's got one foot in dunya, one foot in the akhirah, or in the barzakh right now. The angels say, Al-An, now you believe? Now? Where were you all these years? Musa showed you his signs and everything. Now you believe? That's the instinct that Allah has created in every human being. And that's why, brothers and sisters, I read some of the books written by some of those atheists who claim to be atheists, individuals who write. You find, subhanAllah, one of them, a prominent name, I don't want to mention his name right now, he just died a few months ago. Not even a year ago. Big name. I read his book. Read the last page of his book. So interesting. In his last page of that book, which is, you know, a bestseller, sold millions of copies worldwide. And many people were influenced by this book, unfortunately, to believe that there is no God. In the last page, he says, if this theory, now I'm paraphrasing, I don't know the exact words, you know, but if you read it, you'll see, it's along these lines. If this theory, the M theory, what he calls the M theory, if this theory proves to be what we are deducing it to be, then at that point, our hypotheses, our conclusions will be proven right. If that theory proves to be strong, you know, the way it is, then our conclusions will prove to be right. What does that tell you? Is he certain? So he has written this whole book based on what? Theory. A theory. Which he speculates to be in a particular way. Now, I'm not saying that he doesn't have evidence to this, but his evidence apparently are not conclusive, 100%, to say that, you know what, this is how it is. If the theory proves, which means the theory has not yet even proven 100%. And I was reading about this M theory. There is a professor in Davis, University of Davis, California, Davis, who specializes in the M theory and the string theory. I was reading his homepage. On his homepage, he says, this string theory is such a complicated theory that we have not yet fully understood it. So some people in the field themselves, at reputable universities, are saying, we have not really understood this theory, it's so complicated. And I saw videos of other professors who say the string theory proves there is a God. So subhanAllah. One person says it doesn't prove. One says it proves. The other one says it's so complicated, we don't really understand it. So then how can you write a whole book? But because the name, he has this name, so-and-so, professor so-and-so, khalas. That's it. And millions of people, I have come to debate with some, or discuss with some youth, some people, who are reading these books, and khalas, they're leaving religion. Why? Because Dr. So-and-so says it. Well, I mean, Dr. So-and-so, with all due respect to Dr. So-and-so, he is specializing in a particular field, not in theology. Theology is not his business. Okay. And even his conclusion is saying, if. That tells me back the ayah, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. They rejected the truth, but deep inside, they know it is the truth. Why do they reject it then? Out of oppression and aggression. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. That's what people. So Imam As-Sadiq told this man, he told him, tell him this on the ship. He went back and he told him, he said, yes, that has happened. So when the ship was rocking you back and forth, did you feel a connection to a power that can save you? He said, yes, I did. When I lost hope, all the materialistic ways are finished. You know, we tried. Try this, try that. But everything, خلص, all the doors are now closed. Then he said, I did feel that. He said, that is Allah. That's, you ask him, where is God? This is God. Right there. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. Same thing with Imama. Same thing with Ma'ad. Another atheist comes to Imam As-Sadiq عليه السلام, says, this Quran of yours doesn't make sense. Your God is not fair. He said, how? How did you come to that conclusion? He says, Allah says, كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودُهُمْ, every time their skins ripen in the hellfire, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, may Allah save us from the hellfire. Every time the skin burns, you know, ripens, what happens? Allah replaces it. Replaces it with other skin. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, imagine. God forbid, may Allah not take us near that hellfire. I don't know if any of you has touched a hot teacup one day and how you burnt, and maybe the mark remained for a week or 2 weeks, still hurts. This is touching, you know, a little bit. Imagine putting the hand in the fire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And then it doesn't end. It recovers, reheals, and goes back again. And reheals, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. Who would do this? Who would accept this? If we were to understand this, none of us would disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why our theology is so weak, our aqidah is so weak. Okay. A man comes to the Imam and says, okay, let's say somebody steals. Okay, steals. This skin right there, this is the skin in which he stole. This skin Allah will punish. Okay, makes sense. I understand. But then Allah says we're going to replace it with other skin. That new skin that's going to be developed, that new skin did not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Genius. You know, the guy is a genius. This is one of those people who just reads the Quran and try to interpret it the way he wants. You know, that new skin did not disobey Allah. So why would Allah burn that new skin now? He said, whoa, you misunderstood the ayah. It's the same skin. He said, how could it be the same skin? He said, bring me a brick, a clay brick. The Imam said, clay brick. Back in those days, they used to build with clay bricks. Bring me the clay brick. They brought him a clay brick. He took, you know, he beat the clay. The clay, what happens to it now? It's broken into pieces. Imam pours some water on it. Now what happens to it? It all molds back, you know, and then he molds it, reshapes it back into the same brick. He says, there you go. Tfadal. It's the same brick. Has it changed? It's the same material. Nothing has changed. This is what Allah means. He says, oh, you know, it's that oh moment, you know, oh, you know. No. Wallah, you talk to some people sometimes who, you know, they don't even, I've talked to some people who don't even understand Arabic. At least this man understands Arabic. But even though he understood Arabic, he still didn't understand the ayah. Some people, I have spoken to them, they don't even understand Arabic. They read the translation of the Quran and they come up with some weird interpretations. Yeah. Weird laws. A person says, you know, Allah never says hijab is wajib in the Quran. I was talking to someone. I told him, how did you come to that conclusion? There are ayat in the, oh, I came to that conclusion. I read the ayah. I said, brother, but you don't speak Arabic. You don't even understand Arabic. He says, yeah, I don't need to. I read the English translation. So, yeah, are you serious? You read the English translation of the Quran, not even the Arabic. And you've come up with this conclusion? What a genius, mashallah. Yeah, you cannot do that. You cannot. Even if you understand Arabic, like this man, this atheist, understood Arabic at the time of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, those people spoke Arabic. They understood Arabic. But they still couldn't understand the ayat of the Quran. They had to go back to Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. So with verses about ma'ad, belief, tawheed, Imam had to make sure they understand, those Shia, the Shia understand how to interpret these ayat and strengthen them. A man from Sham comes to the Imam, salamullahi alayhi. He says to the Imam, I want to debate with you. Imam was among his companions, those, the big ones. Zurara ibn Ayun, Himran ibn Ayun, Abban ibn Taghlub, Husham ibn al-Hakam, Husham ibn Salim, and so on and so forth. The man said, I want to debate with you. You, Ja'far ibn Muhammad, yes. He said, I heard you're an alim. You're a scholar. I want to debate with you. Now, when he says a person from Sham, what is the capital of Sham? You know, back in those days, who's in charge of Sham in those days? Huh? The Umayyads. The Umayyads are. So when we say someone from Sham, it means someone who's brainwashed by the ideologies of Bani Umayyah. That's what we mean. So this Shami comes. I want to debate with Imam Salamullah Ali looks at him and he sits back and says, you can debate with my companions. He says, no, I want to debate with you. He says, what do you want to debate about? He says, you know, he starts listing things. For example, the Arabic language. He says, okay. Abban ibn Taghlub, debate with him, please. Sit down and talk to him. He says, I don't want to talk to Abban, I want to talk to you. He says, if you can win in the argument against him, it's as if you've won the argument against me. You see, the trust of the Imam, salamullahi alayhi, he knows these people are well educated, well trained. They're ready. So he debates and he fails in the argument. The Shami fails. Does he finish? No, comes back again. Okay, fine. Arabic, I can't do that. How about we do something else? Imamah. Let's talk about Imamah. No problem. Husham ibn al-Hakam, please go ahead. Talk to him. The second, next. Debates, fails again. Okay, fiqh, I don't know, theology, aqidah, whatever. He starts coming up. Every time the Imam, salamullah alayhi, calls somebody, he says, you go up. And they all discuss and debate, and they win the argument. At the end, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam looks at this man from Sham, says, what did you think of my companions? He says, they're amazing. No, these people, they know what they're talking about. He says, and then the Shami tells Imam al-Sadiq, he says, you wanted to show me that such are your companions. These are the people whom you're educating, you're training to lead the ummah, to lead the nation. These are the leaders. He said, yes, indeed. These are the leaders. These are the ones who will take care of guiding people. And that's what the imams did. Without these people, we would have lost our fiqh and our aqaid. Would have been wasted. I'll give you a very important example, brothers and sisters. There was a case I read about in the newspapers in some Muslim country. I won't mention where. A husband was joking with his wife, sends her a text message, and tells her, you are taliq, you're divorced. I don't know what kind of a husband makes such a joke. Maybe he wants to sleep in the garage. No. So, the lady, who is not from the Shia school of thought, she's from the Sunni school of thought, reads the text, gets scared, runs to her father's house. Father, dad, look, he just sent me a message saying I'm taliq. What? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Ajeeb. The father picks up the phone, calls the sheikh. Says, ya sheikh, you know, the local sheikh. Sheikh, my daughter's husband just sent her a text message saying that she's taliq. So what do we do now? He says, khalas, that's it, she's taliq. She's divorced. But sheikh, he wrote it 3 times. Oh, khalas. It means she can't even go back to him anymore. She has to marry someone else, you know, wait for her iddah, marry someone else, and not just on paper, no, marry someone else. And then he has to divorce her, and then he comes back after the iddah. They called the husband, they, what have you done? He says, what? What did you just write? You ruined the whole family. He said, I was joking. What joking? Khalas. It's done. This made headlines in a newspaper in that country. I read that paper, the article. So a man texts his wife. According to him, he did not even have the intention of doing talaq. He was just joking for, I don't know what came up to him, whatever happened. The whole family is ruined. Khalas. The wife cannot see her husband anymore. She has to go wait for her iddah and then marry someone else, get divorced, and then get back to the husband. This is clear contradiction to the Quran itself. The Quran says when talaq is recited, فَأَشْهِدُ in Surah Al-Talaq, ذَوَيْ عَدْلٍ مِنْكُمْ. There has to be two just people, adl, adalat, people who have adala. They are God-fearing. They fear Allah. Not just anybody from the street, you bring him. No. Someone who's God-fearing. You bring them to witness the talaq. Has to be conditions. A man comes to Imam As-Sadiq, alayhi salam, says, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, I was in the house with my wife. I got upset. So I told talaq. He said, was there anyone in the house to witness the talaq? No, just her and I. He said, then that there is no such divorce. There is no divorce. Go back to your wife. She's your wife. That divorce is invalid. I got upset. I lost it. I said, you're taliq. This is like the man, you know, one day they came to Harun al-Rashid. You know Harun? The Abbasi caliph, the one who killed Imam al-Kadhim, alayhi salam. They brought him a man one day. They said, this man divorced 5 women in one day. He said, how could 5 women? You know, 4, I understand. Where did the 5th one come from? He said, he's married to 4, mashallah. Comes home one day, he's upset. The first wife, you know, talks to him a little bit. He gets upset at her. You're taliq, you're divorced. The second one comes and says, take it easy, take it easy. What? Who are you to tell me to take it easy? You're taliq too. The third one comes and says, what are you doing? You just divorced 2 women. What? You open your mouth? You're taliq too. You really like it, don't you? The 4th one comes, says, my lovely husband, alhamdulillah, good thing you got rid of them. Now it's all me. What? You? You're taliq too. Back in those days, their houses were very small. You know, like old African house, you know, every house is right next to them. So the minute, whatever you say in the house, the whole neighborhood listens. So the neighbor comes and says, what's the matter here? What's going on? You know, taliq, taliq, taliq. What's going on? What's happening? He said, what's it of your business? By Allah, I swear, if your husband gives me permission, I'll divorce you too. The husband says, I give you permission.
So I said, you talaq too.
So five people, you know, subhanAllah, such people, you know, they would divorce the whole world. You know, these people. Imagine such a person becomes your boss at work. Wal'iyadu billah, you know. That's Fir'aun. That's a Fir'aun. You know. You don't have to be the king of Egypt to become a Fir'aun. Sometimes you can be a Fir'aun in the house. You know. So that's what happens. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam clarified it. He said, no, such a divorce is not a divorce. First of all, there are conditions. Amongst the conditions, I won't list them all, but among the conditions, there has to be intent. There's intention here. He has to intend. Not he's joking with his wife, sends her a text message. No, there has to be intention. Among the conditions, there has to be two just witnesses. That's why usually in these days, when a talaq is recited, usually it is recited in front of like 10, 20 people who are mu'mineen. Like, you know, you come to the Husayniyah, for example, 20 people. You hope that out of these 20 people, there's two people who are, inshallah, God-fearing. Otherwise, there will be a problem in the talaq. The talaq will be void. So, these are among the conditions, because here families have to be saved. How many families got destroyed because of this? If you read the papers in some of the Muslim countries, you read the papers, you'll see what kind of stories. Husband gets obsessed at the wife, after 20 years they have children, khalas, three times talaq, and the whole marriage is now finished. So can you imagine what happens when the fiqh is not correct, when the ahkam are not accurate, because they are not based on genuine and pure fountains of knowledge, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, and the Quran. Now you have all this, but then you have the akhlaq. If you have the right aqidah, you have the right ahkam, that should be reflected on your interactions. And that's the hadith that we recited. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam says in this hadith, لا تغتروا بصلاتهم ولا بصيامهم. Don't be fooled by their salat and their siyam. Many people fast, many people pray, many people come to mosque. That does not make them mu'min. You'll have people sometimes praying in the first row of the masjid. But then subhanAllah, the minute they go outside, see them how they deal with people outside. They don't leave a person without shooting an arrow at them. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ Creating problems after problems after problems. And the problem is these people just don't realize it. Or sometimes they do realize it, but they enjoy it. Or they feel that this is how they can show off their power. You know, I can show off my power by putting you down, by destroying you. That means I'm stronger than you. I am better than you. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ So don't be fooled by their salat or their siyam. That does not mean salat and siyam are not important. No. It means that you should understand what is salat and what is siyam. Because salat should prevent you from doing such things. Do not be fooled by their salat and their siyam. فَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ رُبَّمَا لَهِجَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالصَّوْمِ حَتَّى لَوْ تَرَكَهُ اسْتَوْحَشْ Because there could be a person who is so used to praying and fasting that if he leaves it, he'd miss it. He's used to, it's a routine. Since he was little, his parents or her parents, for example, taught her how to pray. So she's now raised, khalas, 20 years she's praying. She's used to it. Or he's used to it. He cannot let go of his salat and siyam. I remember, wallah, one of my teachers one day, he told me, he said in Iraq, one day I was talking to someone who was an atheist. He was debating with me about the existence of Allah. And he's an alim, this alim was saying. He was debating, and then the adhan came. He said, oh, Sayyid, excuse me, I'm going to go pray and then come back and finish. I said, wait a minute. You were just debating with me about whether there is a God or there is no God. Who are you going to pray to? He says, I don't know, Sayyid, you know, don't ask. He says, since I was little, I've been praying, khalasa. It's a habit. I have to go pray. No, even then it's fine. Even that is fine. You pray to Allah, maybe one day his salat will guide him, inshallah. Maybe his salat will guide him. We don't tell such people, stop praying. No, we tell them, inshallah, you understand the essence of your salat. The imam is saying, some people are like this man. They're used to it. Since he was little, he's praying. Since he was little, he was coming to mosque. Since he was little, he's fasting. He cannot stop it. He does it. But then how do you test people? He says, test them. وَلَكِنْ اخْتَبِرُوهُمْ Test them. عند صدق الحديث وأداء الأمانة When they talk, they speak truthfully. And then when they deal with people, they deal honestly. That's when you tell someone is a mu'min, a muttaqi. And he himself says, there was a man, he himself says, whom I heard the lay people, غِثَاء النَّاسِ, means the people who don't understand anything about religion. They were praising him. They're saying, such a great man. He is a alim. What a great alim he is. He says, so I followed him one day. I saw him going by a baker. He looked around. Nobody was seeing. He stole a piece of bread and ran away with it. I was surprised. But I said, maybe he had made an arrangement with this guy. I don't want to come to a conclusion. Then he went by someone who sells fruits. He stole one pomegranate and again, hid it under his abaya and ran away with it. Then I followed him. He saw a poor person. He gave him the bread and the pomegranate. And he walked away. He says, I followed him. I told him, wait a minute. I just saw you doing something that, you know, it suggests something. I just want to confirm. I want to make sure. He said, what did you see me do? He said, I saw you, you know, you appear to have stolen the bread and the pomegranate. And then you gave them as sadaqah. Is that what you did? He says, yes. He says, what have you just done? He says, who are you? What, you don't know anything about religion? He's telling Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, what do you mean? He says, Allah says in the Quran, when you commit a sin, it counts as one. So how many sins did I commit? Two sins. I stole a bread and a pomegranate. That's two sins. But when you do an act of charity, it's multiplied by how much? 10 times. So I gave 2 charities, that's 20. Take 2 out, 18. We're good business, brother. What's the problem? What's the matter? Don't you know math? You don't understand religion. Imam looks at him. Wallah, this is what happens when people don't understand the Quran, huh? By the way, you're laughing. This is from Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam. This is a hadith in Kitab al-Kafi, the hadith. You have today people who come to you and give you strange things about religion, strange ahkam of religion. That's why we need to learn to the fuqaha, the faqih, the marja' al-taqlid. If we throw the marja' al-taqlid aside, this is what happens. You'll have every Tom, Dick, and Harry coming and saying, this is what religion is about. You'll have some people who don't even understand whether Islam is spelled by seen or sad. Those guys will start giving you ahkam. This is halal and this is haram. People go to sometimes universities, professors, and they come up with all different interpretations of history and whatever. And I get emails sometimes. Sheikh, is it true that the Quran says this, this, this? Is it true that our religion does this, this? And I reply, where did you get this from? I went to this professor one day and this is what they said in the classroom. Or I attended this majlis one day and this is what this person says. Or I was speaking to this some, and so on and so forth. Wal-iyadu billah. You have to go to the maraja'u taqleed. You can't ignore those people. You can't say, wallah, they are living in Najaf, they're living in Qom, in the middle of nowhere, and who knows, khala, what does he know about our lives in the West? With all due respect, with all due respect, I give this one very important example, and I've given it here in the past, I repeat it again. 3 years ago, what happened in Iraq? Did you guys see what happened in Iraq 3 years ago? The whole country was about to collapse, the whole country, within hours. The whole country was about to collapse. How many lives were shattered by those terroristic groups that entered? How many women were killed? How many children were killed? How many women were raped? How many men were killed? How much blood was shed by those individuals who claim to understand religion? They claim to understand. That's the problem when there is aqidah. They have aqidah, but the problem is their aqidah is messed up. It's not genuine aqidah. It's messed up aqidah. They have a belief. They're acting out of belief. Or at least they seem, they claim to be. They claim to be acting out of belief. But this is not the belief of Ahlul Bayt. This is not the belief of the Quran. Not the belief of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The whole country was about to be collapsed. What did this person who was sitting in Najaf know about what is happening? What does he know about politics? Huh? What does he know about war? But he demonstrated to the whole world that he knows more about it than the whole world. Yes, he's sitting in this small house, correct? Maybe he doesn't leave this house, but that doesn't mean he doesn't know what's going on in this world. I know one of them, Araja'u Taqleed today, one of them, I know. His son told me, my father, every morning, spends a couple of hours reading all the local newspapers. He says, he tells people, give me all the local newspapers. So for example, if you're living in Canada, for example, the National Post, the Globe and Mail, the Edmonton Journal, for example, whatever those available, bring them to me. And he goes through them. He knows exactly what is going on in this world. He knows exactly what is happening in the world. He tried to keep up to the best of his ability. Then when people come to visit him, how many people come to visit the Maraji' al-Taqleed every day, every year? And they come from all over the world. All over the world. Some of them come from Pakistan. Some of them come from India. Some come from America, Australia, etc., etc. When they come, you try it one day. Sometimes you try it. They come and they ask you, so where do you come from? Sometimes they ask you, when they have time, where do you come from? Or they have sheikh, ulamas, sayyids, who live in these countries, who report to them. What is life like in India? What are things like? Which city do you come from in India? What city do you come from in Australia? Where are you from? How many masjids do you have there? How many, for example, Husayniyas, Imam, they ask you all these questions. When they hear, for example, you come from a village or a city that does not have Husayniyas, they say, how come? Why isn't there a Husayniyah there yet? Are there Shias there? You tell them, yes, there are. Then how come they don't have a Husayniyah? Let's try to do something here. Yes, so he tries to encourage people. He himself doesn't go and build, because he can't. But he delegates. He delegates. This marja' al-taqleed, yes, he's sitting between four walls, but with one fatwa that was very well written and thought about. MashaAllah, 3 million people jumped, and mashaAllah, within a few years, alhamdulillah, the whole country is now clear. We all go to ziyarah today with the barakah of the imams, alayhim as-salam, and these great marja' al-taqleed. Allah and Ahlul Bayt and these great ulamas. That's what Imam al-Sadiq wanted. That's all because of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam and Ahlul Bayt and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and the Quran. Ahlul Bayt did not establish the religion. The religion is from Allah. Established by who? Who established the religion? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi established it. He established the religion. He is the one who taught people. But what Ahlul Bayt made sure is that the Prophet laid the foundation. They made sure to build this foundation, to make it perfect. We have 12 imams. The Prophet died in the year 11 after Hijrah. Imam al-Mahdi, ajalallah ta'ala, farajahu al-Sharif, went into Ghaiba. Allahum salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Went into Ghaiba in the year 250 after Hijrah. Ghaiba al-Sughra. That means, 260 after Hijrah. 260. That means 250 years after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Plus, you had 69 years of Ghaiba al-Sughra. You add those two on top. That's more than 300 years. These 300 years, more than 300 years, the imams made sure this building is built and it's airtight. Perfect. It's perfect. The Prophet introduced it, it was perfect. But people did not realize its perfection. The imams made sure to show this perfection to the people. Because it took 300 years, many people asked questions, problems, political situations changed. All these dynamics were introduced. The imam showed us what to do and how to deal with these situations. And ulama'u al-taqleed, maraja'u al-taqleed today show us what our imams taught us, alayhim as-salam. We are all indebted to our imam. Imam al-Sadiq, alayhi as-salam, looks at this person who told him, you know, I make 20, I lose 2. So you don't understand a thing from the Quran. Don't you read the Quran? It says, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah only accepts from those who are pious, God-fearing. In other words, your deed from the beginning has to be pure so that your good actions would be pure. If you steal and you give to charity, who cares? That's what like that president is doing, stealing billions and gives a little bit to people and says, look, I'm bringing jobs. I'm bringing jobs to people. Look what I'm doing here. You know. Or you have some people, wal'ayadu billah, who steal other people's money, and they come to the Husayniyah, they pray, they fast, and then they give charity. They say, wallah, we give sadaqat, we give a lot of charity. Who cares about your money and your sadaqat and your charity? If it's all haram. That's what the imam wanted to ensure, that his Shia have the morality, the akhlaq, to deal with people accurately. But it wasn't easy. I was reading about the history of the Imam Salamullahi Alayhi. Imam's imama was 34 years, as I mentioned. The first 17, it was divided into two parts exactly, half and half. So the first 17 years was with Bani Umayyah, and the remaining 17 was with Bani al-Abbasids. It was half and half. Those 17 latter years were very difficult. More than once, the Imam Salamullah alayh was summoned by the Khalifa, and he wanted to kill him, more than once. At one point, the Khalifa orders the house of the Imam to be burnt. So some people come, they shoot fire into the house of the Imam, Salamullahi alayhi. The fire is in the burning in the middle of the house. The Imam sees his women, his children, they got scared. So they start to run from one room to another room. The Imam, Salamullahi alayhi, looked at the fire. He managed to take care of the fire and shut it off. Then he sat down and started weeping out loud. Some of the Shia came to visit him to try to comfort the Imam, Salamullahi alayhi. They saw him crying loudly, out loud. They said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, what is the matter? Did it hurt you that they burnt your house? Is that what hurt you? He says, no, that's not what hurt me. He said, then what is the matter? Why are you crying so loudly? He says, because when the fire started to rage in the house, I saw my women, my children, the little girls, they started to get scared. And they started running from one room to another room. And I was there with them. I was with them. I was comforting them. I was telling them, don't worry. I was taking care of the fire. So I remembered the children of my grandfather, Imam al-Hussein, salamullahi alayhi. If my children were crying and weeping because of the fire in the middle of the house, and I am with them, their father is with them, their husband is with them, their brother is with them, how did my aunt Zainab alayhi salam feel on that day when she saw the tents go up in flames? How did Sukayna, the daughter of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, feel on that day when there was no Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas left anymore, and there was no Abi Abdullah al-Hussein left anymore? The children, the women, they were all crying, running in fear. Everyone crying, Aywa Husayna, Aywa Abata. They came to Zainab alayha salam. The little children, they don't understand what's going on. Amma Zainab, where is our father Abu Abdullah? What is happening here? The tents are burning. And then they ask her, where is our uncle Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas? Why wouldn't he come? The whole journey he was taking care of us. She tells them, now they are with your grandfather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. She runs to the tent of Imam As-Sajjad. My nephew, what shall we do? The tents are up in flames. They're burning. He says, my aunt, take the women, take the children, run away from the flames, run away from them. So she gathers all the women, the children, running in the deserts away from the fire. And then she turns to Umar ibn Sa'ad. She says, Ya ibn Sa'ad, what are you doing to us? But instead of any help, she sees him calling 10 men who ride on their horses, and they crush the body of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein and in front of Zainab salamullahi alayha. At that moment, she cried, Aywa jaddah ya Rasulallah. هَذَا حُسَيْنُكَ فِي الْعَرَايَا. This is your Hussein alone in Karbala. A body without a head, a body under the horses of Bani Umayyah. Then she turns to Kufa. She says, السلام عليك يا أبتا يا أمير المؤمنين. Father Ali ibn Abi Talib, where are you? Come and see your Hussein in Karbala under the horses of Bani Umayyah. And come and see your daughters are being beaten by the enemies of Allah. She turns, where is Sukayna? Sukayna's gone missing. She runs looking after her. Where is she? Where is she?
she finds her hugging the body of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn, the body full of arrows and spears. She says, my little girl, what brings you here? At this time, she says, Amma Zainab, Aunt Zainab, when the tents went up in flames, I thought my father can protect me, can look after me. I came, I saw him, a body without a head. I hugged him, I started calling his name. Father, this is your beloved daughter. Answer me, answer me. But he would not reply to me, my aunt. She says, my little girl, he's now with your grandfather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Come back with me. She comforts everyone now that it is night. Everyone has now calmed down a little bit. She now gets up. Zainab, where are you going? She says, I need to go see my brother Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. She goes to the body of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. She says, Ya Abu al-Fadl, you took care of me from Medina to Karbala. Now you leave me all alone with no support on my own. Some of the poets, they try to answer, they try to paint a picture here. They say, as if Abu al-Fadl responds, as if he answers, how would he say? What would he say? He would say, Zainab, don't blame me. If I had my right hand and my left hand, if they did not shoot me with an arrow in my eye, Zainab, I would have gotten up. I would have defended you. So forgive me, Zainab. I don't have my hands on me. Brothers and sisters, raise your hands in the dua. Really, brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam says, revive our traditions. Sit down in such majalis and remember us, like what we just did. And then he makes a dua to all of us. He says, Rahim Allah man ahya amrana. May Allah have mercy on the one who sits in our majalises to remember us. Yani all of you, inshallah, all of us here, we are, inshallah, included in the dua of the mercy of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. This is a big ni'mah, a big ni'mah. Do not let go of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Don't let go of them. It's a great ni'mah. And inshallah, now it's the time when du'as are accepted and answered. Let us all together pray. Many mu'mineen have asked us for hajat, to fulfill their needs. Some are ill. Some of them who are suffering from lack of peace and security, some parts of the world. Others who have other needs. We all have hajat and have needs. May Allah grant us the shafa'ah of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. May Allah, inshallah, make us among the Shia of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. May Allah grant us the ziyarah of Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam. May Allah make us witness the rebuilding of the shrines of Imam As-Sadiq and the other imams in Baqi' soon, inshallah. May Allah give us the tawfiq to attend the majalis in Baqi' inshallah. Hold majalis in Baqi' inshallah. Soon, inshallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasten the reappearance of our imam, ajjalallah ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. Make us and our children until the day of judgment among his shia, inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء اللهم يا الله عجل لوليك الفرج يا الله اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا
حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. لقضاء الحوائج، شفاء المرضى، كشف هذه الغمة عن هذه الأمة، ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان. إلى أرواح أمواتنا وأموات الجالسين والحاضرين والشهداء والعلماء، رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات. الله صل على محمد وعلى آله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد